This presentation is about writing Lewis structures for covalent compounds. It's one of the more challenging tasks in this class, but with a little practice, most people become relatively good at this. Okay, so the whole thing starts with Lewis dot structures, and this is based upon things that we already know. We know that in the first period of the periodic table, we have hydrogen and helium, and the only orbital they have available to them is the 1s orbital. In the second and subsequent periods, all of the elements will always have an s subshell and a p subshell. Remember that the s subshell contains one orbital, the p subshell contains three orbitals. The p's can hold six electrons, the s's can hold two, so aside from the first period on the periodic table, elements generally will contain eight electrons as a maximum. Okay, so let's kind of lay these here. So this is kind of what I said just a minute ago, that the hydrogen and helium atoms, they have one single orbital that we can place electrons into, so the maximum number of electrons we can place in those is two. In the next period, each of these elements has access to s and p orbitals, so they each can hold up to eight electrons in them. So let's kind of go through this. Since hydrogen is in group one, it has one electron, so we draw that as a dot. This is what was developed by Mr. Lewis probably about 100 years ago now, but it's a means of illustrating the bonding in atoms. Helium has two electrons, and as such, it has a full shell of electrons. And this full shell of electrons is what we're going to be aiming for as we start to put atoms together in a way that they share electrons. The goal of sharing electrons is for each atom to achieve a full shell. Lithium is also in group one, so one dot. Beryllium is in group two, so it gets two dots. And I've kind of put these in arbitrary, but the one thing I do know is electrons are negatively charged, so it's going to be hard to put them into the same orbital together with one another. It's more likely that they're going to occupy different orbitals, so I put them in obviously different orbitals. Boron is in group 3A, so three valence electrons. So one, two, three. And then I get to carbon, group 4A, so four valence electrons. And with those four valence electrons, I have one electron in each orbital, and that's the point where any subsequent electrons that are added need to be paired up. So I'm going to do that. So with nitrogen, it is in group 5, so that fifth electron gets paired up. And it's arbitrary, it's artistic license where you like these dots and pairs. It doesn't really matter. There's no real logic to it, as long as you have the correct number of electrons and paired as needed, single if need be as well. Okay, oxygen is in group 6, so as I click through this, I put in 6 electrons, so that means oxygen has 2 full orbitals and 2 that only have one electron in them. And then fluorine is in group 7, so all but one of its electrons are going to be paired. And then we get to the end of the row, and neon has 8 electrons, and we generally call that an octet of electrons, or sometimes I just call it a full shell of electrons. So neon is full with 8, and we'll be looking for 8 electrons as we start to put element or atoms together to construct covalent molecules. Okay, so one place we can start is with a simple molecule like water. Water is constructed using 2 hydrogen atoms and 1 oxygen atom. And if we recall from the previous slide, hydrogen was in group 1, so it has 1 valence electron each. And then oxygen has 6 valence electrons. And with 6 valence electrons, we're going to have 2 pairs and 2 unpaired electrons. And if we can imagine putting these together in such a way to complete octets, we might imagine those 2 hydrogen atoms kind of sliding in like puzzle pieces to complete the octet on oxygen. And once that happens, then we'll see that the oxygen ends up with 8 electrons surrounding it, and each hydrogen is going to be in contact with 2 electrons, so they both achieve a full valence shell. And quite a few molecules can be put together simply using this kind of puzzle piece method. So let's check those full shells. So oxygen has 8 electrons in that circle, and then hydrogen has 2 electrons in that circle, and then 2 electrons again for the other hydrogen. Sometimes the picture gets a little bit more hard to see. If I looked at carbon, and I don't know that my first step in this is to show the Lewis structure of the naked atoms, but carbon has 4 valence electrons and each oxygen has 2 valence electrons. When I slide those together as puzzle pieces, then I end up with a couple of stray electrons. So one method of solving these puzzles is to add up the valence electrons. So I've got 16 total valence electrons. So I'm going to add those up. I'm going to determine the center atom, and I usually go with the atom that's different from the others. So I've got 3 atoms here. 2 of them are oxygen, 1 is carbon. So I'm going to put the carbon at the center. The other rationales for putting elements at the center kind of go this way. The largest atom usually goes at the center because the largest atom is going to have more space to bond with other atoms. The other criteria that we often use is the most electropositive, so the opposite of electronegative. So in other words, the one that's furthest away from fluorine is likely to be the center atom. And sometimes you just start to get a feel for this. So I'm going to attach those with single bonds. So I've just used up 4 electrons. Remember, each bond is representing 2 electrons. So I've got 4 electrons used up. I've got 12 more to distribute. And I then just kind of distribute these, and I usually try to complete the octet on at least one of the atoms and then distribute the remaining electrons symmetrically and then work from there. So I distributed those, and then I check for octets. And when I circle the atoms and all the pairs that they're in contact with, I see that carbon has a full octet in this at this step, but the oxygens have only 6 electrons in their circle. So what we want to do then is to start shuffling electrons from any atom that has a completed valence shell to share with atoms that don't have a completed valence shell. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to move a pair off of the carbon because it has 8, and I'm going to slide it down between that carbon atom and one of the adjacent oxygen atoms. So when I do that, I end up with a structure that looks like this. So I can check for full shells again. And when I do this, I see now I have 8 electrons around that oxygen on the right. I still have 8 electrons on the carbon. So you see, if I move an electron pair from an unshared position to a shared position, it doesn't decrease the number of electrons for that original atom. So in this case, carbon still has kept its 8 electrons. It's just sharing 2 more electrons than it did previously. So then we go again. Since I have 1 atom, the atom on the left has 6 electrons. So I need to repeat the process, and carbon still has 1 more pair of electrons that it can share with oxygen. So I'm going to do that. And when I do that, I now end up with octets on every atom. So sometimes we have to do steps 6 and 7 a couple times in order to get to the correct answer. Okay, sometime you may run into a ion, so a covalent ion. We've looked at these polyatomic ions, and they always contained oxygen and a nonmetal. Here's one of the ones that are different than the oxygen model. This is cyanide, and I've got carbon and nitrogen, and I have a negative charge. And remember that when we were dealing with binary ionic compounds, that things with negative charges had gained electrons. So negative means that I'm gaining electrons in this case. So let's start with adding these electrons up. So carbon has 4 valence electrons, nitrogen has 5 valence electrons. Those come from the group numbers, remember. And then I've got a negative charge, so I've got to add 1 electron for that negative charge. So I end up with 10 valence electrons. I don't know which atom, you know, is the center atom. When you only have a binary compound, it probably doesn't matter. So I'm going to connect them with a single bond. So I just used up 2 electrons. I've got 8 electrons to give. And my general strategy is to try to complete the shell of one of these 2 atoms. And arbitrarily, I completed the shell for carbon. So carbon now has an octet of electrons. And nitrogen is very obviously short of that count of 8 electrons. But I've circled it anyways here. So my next steps are to start shuffling pairs off of carbon into a shared position with nitrogen. So I'm going to move 1 pair at a time. It works better if you try to move 1 pair at a time than to move them all at once, because then it just starts to get crazy and you do something silly and you erase a pair and then it doesn't end up in the right place. So anyways, I've moved 1 pair off of carbon down to a shared position. So carbon still has 8 electrons around it, but the nitrogen now went from 4 to 6 electrons, so things are getting better for nitrogen. I'm going to repeat this one more time, moving another pair down between carbon and nitrogen to hopefully complete the shell for nitrogen and not affect the shell for carbon. So this is what that would look like. So I end up with 3 pairs. So we would call this a triple bond. If I have 1 pair, I call it a single bond. 2 pairs down between, I get a double bond. A third pair is a triple bond. And that's pretty much the limit in terms of what's possible for atoms. So when I check for octets, everybody has an octet here. Okay, again, a charged molecular ion. So I've got a carbonate ion here. So rather than having a -1 charge, I've got a -2 charge. So I've got to throw in 2 more electrons when I'm counting them up. So let's see, I've got 4 for the carbon, each oxygen has 6, and then I throw in 2 more electrons for the charge, and I come up with 24 valence electrons. I put the carbon at the middle because it just seems right, because carbon is different than the other 3 atoms, so I'm going to put it at the center. But if I, you know, just couldn't remember that, carbon is further away from fluorine, and carbon is also larger than oxygen. Remember, the size trend goes from right to left. So on every count, carbon should be the center atom. Okay, so I'm attaching those atoms and distributing the remaining electrons, and I was able to complete octets on all but 1 of the atoms. So I have 1 atom without an octet, but it's connected to carbon that has an octet. So I should be able to slide that 1 pair of electrons off of the carbon down into a shared position with that oxygen on the left. So I guess that wasn't full shell. So here we go with the next step here. I slid that electron pair down. When I check for octets, everybody's got octets. I don't have to repeat the process. Now, one thing that I'm going to point out here, it's not probably the most important thing in all of this class, but for those of you that may continue on into other chemistry courses, there is the concept of something called resonance. So as I drew this, it was kind of arbitrary that that double bond landed on the oxygen on the left. It could have, you know, depending upon how I initially distributed the electrons, ended up on the right or even on that bottom oxygen. And all of those positions are geometrically equivalent, so we say that this has resonance, that double bond can kind of bounce around between all of those locations. In fact, when we measure the bond lengths between carbon and oxygen for carbonate, we don't end up with 2 single bonds and a double bond length. We end up with 3 bonds that are exactly equal to one another, so that those pair of electrons are kind of bouncing around so fast that we can't even nail them down in one location. Okay, so here's the opposite. I've got a positively charged ion. So I've got ammonium here, and we go through the same process here, but with a positive charge, I've got to take an electron away. That's just like when we created cations. So if I had a sodium ion It loses an electron in order to look like a noble gas. And the same thing for these molecular ions. So 5 electrons for nitrogen, each hydrogen had 1, and then I take one away. So I end up with 8 valence electrons for this molecular ion. So I'm going to stick nitrogen at the middle because that just feels right, and it is certainly larger as a second period element than hydrogen. And then I distribute the remaining electrons. There are no remaining electrons. In order to get all of those hydrogens attached, I had to use 4 bonds, and that is 8 electrons. So I'm basically done at this point. So I didn't have to go any further. I didn't have to create double bonds. In fact, one thing to remember is that the smaller the atom, the less likely it is to form double bonds. So hydrogen never forms double bonds. Another one that almost never forms double bonds is going to be fluorine. I can't think of an instance where fluorine forms a double bond. Okay, just like has been the case for some of the other presentations that I've done, I have essentially a worksheet here for you to contemplate and hopefully try so that we can turn this in. Try to construct these ions, or not ions, but molecules and ions using Lewis structures. And I would tell you the worst thing that you could do for yourself is to go Google what the Lewis structures for each of these are, because you're not learning anything then. Maybe if you have toiled with these for some time and then want to check your work, then by all means go and check it, but don't go and just copy the Lewis structures that are available. One thing I'll tell you is that I will know if you have done this, because at least one of these, if you are using more sophisticated bonding rules, you'll come up with a structure that won't match what match the rules for this course. So it would be in your best interest to do these on your own. And I guess that's about it. Have fun drawing Lewis structures.